From a little closet in Chico, California. Straight to your headphones.
Synthesis Radio.
When one behemoth of Seattle-bred indie rock collides with an up-and-coming purveyor of Christian-bred indie rock, sparks will fly. Jeremy Enig, former frontman for Sunny Day Real Estate and The Fire Theft, and Aaron Weiss, frontman for Me Without You, are prime examples of social responsibility, whether it be for their lyrical posterity, their mutual realization of love in the world, or their mutual appreciation for alternative energy sources. Weiss is a major fan of Enig, and Enig of Weiss. Enough so that Enig contributed vocals to two tracks on Me Without You's newest album, Brother Sister. What was supposed to be a mutual interview for Synthesis Magazine blossomed into a lengthy conversation about religion, God, politics, and other things you probably shouldn't discuss at family dinners. Too important and engaging to chop into two parts, please enjoy the next hour-long conversation.
First, tell me if it's true. A friend of mine told me that your band runs your bus off an alternative fuel source.
Yes.
This is true.
Yeah, about a year and a half ago, we got an extra fuel tank in our bus that filters and heats waste vegetable oil. So we can go out back of restaurants like Chinese buffets and steakhouses and things like that. And there's usually a big dumpster filled with the grease that's used up from the kitchen fryer, and they just dump it out there for somebody to come and haul away. And we have a hose we stick in that dumpster and pump it out into our tank and then use it as fuel. So we very, very seldom have to buy any diesel or
tour for practically for free as far as oil or as fuel.
Absolutely. The oil is totally free. We've never paid for it. But you do have to change the filters more frequently because the grease that you're getting is not a controlled substance like the diesel that you're buying at a gas station, you know. So you have to compete with these sesame seeds or french fries or tiny particles that are invisible to the eye, but they'll still clog up a filter faster than diesel would.
What's your reason? I mean, did you do it for costs or did you do it for environmental reasons or is it both? Or
It's a little of both. The main thing for me was all this talk about the war and how... I mean, there's no way to really know our country's motivations for this or that, but it's always seemed to be tied in with oil, and this just seemed unconscionable to me and to a few of us, but it was like a big financial investment up front, and we had to spend between all the parts and the labor and all the filters, like something like $6,000. We thought, boy, you know, at least at first, saving money wasn't the appeal, but we eventually have. Since then, we've saved probably over $20,000 in fuel,
which is a huge perk.
Yeah, it definitely helps to keep everybody on board, even the guys who don't necessarily see the importance of, like, trying to cut out our dependence on, like, foreign oil, that sort of thing, or the environmental dangers of, like, depending on a limited and kind of rapidly depleting resource. There's a lot of good reasons to do it, for me, I guess it's a little of everything. I'm kind of a born cheapskate, so I sure can't stay away from a bargain like that, you know, free fuel. And it works, you know, we probably run 95% off of the vegetable oil. Still a little bit of diesel, but almost nominal.
I'd love to hook up with you, and hopefully you would, like, sort of guide me into doing that myself, because I totally admire that. Like,
for
environmental reasons, and I agree with, like, the whole, like, you know, as far as the war, it's just like, you know, why is it such an issue to, you know, even be fighting over something that could be solved with vegetable oil or, you know, hemp oil or a bicycle, right?
In many cases, at least. But yeah, touring, of course, a bicycle isn't. So yeah, if you do want to do it, you'll have to either have a diesel van or a diesel bus to start out with, because you can't do it with a gasoline engine. Or you'll have to ride on the bus with us when we tour together or something like that. And then
you
won't have to worry about forgive me, I'm sorry. Kind of can't.
Yeah, which has got to happen soon.
Save the day, you know, any day of the week, we'll start it. My brother's in Vietnam right now, but I think he would fly home for the opportunity.
When's the next time you guys are touring?
We're doing a little bit. We have most of the summer off. We were, I think, going to start our next one at the end of August and go out to the, what's that festival in Seattle called? The Bumbershoot.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, I thought I'd heard that, and I was pretty stoked to think that maybe we would cross paths. I don't know if it's on the same day or anything, but
on the third.
On the third, yeah. I'm not sure what day we're playing. Yeah, I'll have to find out and see if we can. I mean, I could show you the bus and give you the whole tutorial of how the grease works, and then
of course,
if you ever wanted to come and sing with us, you know, for the stuff that you recorded, you know, you're obviously more than
yeah.
welcome.
I love the album, dude, and I love the mix, you know. I know we're supposed to be asking questions, but you're totally hitting like more of a melodic thing. Like I heard your last record, and it, you know, you're starting to do melodies, and you're branching out, and it sounds awesome. I love it.
Wow, thank you. Yeah, I've never known how to write melodies. I was a drummer before, and then I decided I really wanted to write lyrics and do vocals, but I couldn't write a melody to save my life. And then I just sort of started forcing myself to, and I was never very confident. So I'm glad to hear you say that. Especially, you know, and as you said, I know we're just supposed to be asking questions, but I mean, I'm you know, a big fan, of course, of your singing and your melodies in particular. It's just like, so yeah, I appreciate it. And what can I say? I don't even know what to say, but thank you.
You said it. You're welcome. And yeah. Okay, another question. Okay, this one's, bear with me on how I ask this. I'm reading it from a pad of paper. So I understand that you believe in a God, right?
Yes.
Can you describe what kind of connection you have with this unseen force? I mean, how does God manifest itself in your life? Can you describe the relationship that you have with God? Do you have you seen any specific miracles or any specific circumstances that made you aware of this ever-present force?
I'm going to try. I don't think I'll do the right job at trying to verbalize it, but I'm going to try. I suppose the God that I believe in and the God of my understanding comes from the gospel and the teachings of Jesus, and particularly there's a verse in one of the letters written by John that made its way into the Bible that said that if anyone loves, he knows God because God is love. But if you don't love, then you don't know God. So to me, I don't mean to take just one verse out of the context of the whole rest of the Bible, but it seems like that is the context of the whole Bible. For all the things I don't quite understand and sometimes don't always agree with that are in the Bible, it's a big book written by a lot of people, of course. So my faith in God doesn't come just from the fact that I read the Bible, that I go to a church building on Sunday or something like that. I wasn't raised as a Christian, but my mom's Sufi Muslim, my dad's Jewish. They taught me to pray and to believe in one God, but never Jesus or his teachings or his crucifixion or anything like that. To me, as simple as I can put it, is that I believe that God is love, and that I'm not sure if it's too big a leap to say that therefore love is God, but there's another scripture that says every good and perfect gift is from above. And so I have to believe that any goodness that there is in the world, anything perfect, anything beautiful, any wisdom, any gentleness, any kindness, any peacefulness, is the evidence of God or the fruit of God, a physical manifestation of God that we can see and touch and not necessarily measure or scientifically categorize, but experience firsthand and not just accept blindly. It may be a step of faith to trust that this power of gentleness and peace has a sort of a guiding hand in my life. I can't prove that. And the only experience that I've had or sort of miracle that I've tasted firsthand was the fact that for most of my life I thought about not much else besides killing myself. And then even after becoming a Christian and accepting the Christian religion, I didn't feel much of a change in that. And then just shy of 3 years ago, I had a sort of encounter where I felt like Paul in the Bible, where he was knocked off his donkey and blinded, and then all of a sudden everything was different. And the only thing that changed was where this simple idea of love and this reality of love, not an idea or a belief or a religion, but just a reality, a real place, a real decision or a commitment or action, a life.
Totally not scientific, but completely provable through, love itself is, that's gorgeous.
Yeah, I hope I don't mean to fumble around and talk too much about it, because the reality is, as deep as it is, you know, so deep that nobody, no matter how brilliant, can fully explain or understand, it's also something so simple I think any child really can understand on a certain level. So forgive me if I'm too wordy with it. I really want to just insist that it is this incredible reality that truly we can't touch or taste or measure, but that we all know exists on some level, and perhaps there's been so much wrong done in the name of God, it's hard to even use the language of of faith and to say God or prayer, because it calls to mind all this hypocrisy or all these political ties. But there's still something very critical to me about not just acknowledging this love, but bowing down and worshiping and thanking and singing songs to praise this love and to seek the guidance and the will of this love. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. You mentioned your parents being, you know, Muslim and Jewish. I mean, what was that like?
Yeah, it was.
Can you describe that? And did they pressure you or not? I mean,
for a while, I think, especially after started going to a church building and reading the Bible, there was this like pressure from them. No, you've got to, you know, believe what we believe, and then I would try to convert them. And no, you've got to accept what I believe. And this went on for quite a while until this sort of profound experience that I just described, where I realized it's not my duty to convert anybody, it's my duty to love everybody, and that God would bring about the conversion of one's heart if that's what needs to happen. But all the arguing stopped, and all the fighting stopped, and the disagreement, and rather than trying to convert each other, we found a lot of common ground, and since I've been able to go to my mom's mosque and worship the God that I believe in that building, and both of my parents have come to, you know, worship services with my church and have sung songs to God.
Wow.
With me in that context, and it's just been much, much more beautiful and free and alive. And so I've just been really tremendously grateful for that unity that God's been able to bring, even across the outer forms of different religions. And I'm not claiming that all religions are the same, but certainly that there is one God, and that there is truth to be found anywhere you look.
Right.
Did you have a religious upbringing yourself, or did your parents?
My father was Catholic, and my mother was Christian. Or they both still are, yeah. And there was a conflict there as well, you know, believe it or not, even though they both believed in the same sort of sect, you know, more or less, in Jesus, ultimately. I was raised mainly Christian. I went to church with my mom to a Christian church that was very dogmatic. They believed, I was raised to believe that this specific church with the name Church of Christ is the only church that you can go to if you want to go to heaven.
Oh,
and
boy.
Everybody else, if they do not go to, with that title, Church of Christ, that you will go to hell.
Wow.
And this is nothing, you know, it was just dogmatic. It's nothing against my family. They're wonderful. It's just what it was like, you know, 20, 30 years ago.
Yes. I'm familiar with that church, by the way. I encounter people from that and felt that very spirit. So I know just what you're talking about.
Right. But for me, it was extremely important to discover it for myself. Not only take what other people tell me to believe, but take what other people believe and actually measure it in my own heart and see how it sits and how it goes through the filter of my own heart. And
right.
So I think I feel pretty lucky to have had a fairly open mind about it and discover God on my own.
Right.
You know, but always taking advice, always being open to people's opinions, and because you got to be, because in life the main problem why there's war and there's issues, major issues, is people. It's other people because of their difference of opinion. So
right.
Of course you have to measure their opinion because they are your teachers.
Right.
But yeah, I was raised in that thing, and
it's that time that you said that you decided to adopt this for yourself. Was that around when the Sunny Day Real Estate Pink album came out? Right before that was when you, if I remember rightly, and you have to forgive me if I'm sort of following, you know, knowing about this at a distance,
right.
Whatever I read on the internet, you know, or something like that. And I, you know how it goes, you know, I was a, you know, huge Sunny Day fan, and I remember when I read a letter that you'd written, sort of announcing to whoever was interested that you had this encounter with Christ. Was that sort of the turning point for you, or was that, was there several times
that was
the
catalyst.
That point that was the catalyst?
It was a revelation. It was a direct, I had seen miracles happen in my life. For example, I was on tour with the band, and I decided to test my faith one day, and I gave away all my money that I had to the point where I couldn't eat for a day or two. And so I gave away all my money. I couldn't afford food for myself. But I knew, you know, I knew that I'm going to be taken care of. You know, I'm a child of Earth, you know. I'm a child of God. One day I get to the club to do sound check. And I'm starving. I'm miserable. And I said, why did I not just keep $10? But I gave it all away. I did this extremist thing where I gave everything away.
Yeah.
And, you know, but I couldn't. I started doubting. I was like, I could have just had kept $10, and I could have went to Taco Bell and had like a cheap meal just to feed me. I'm hungry. Suddenly one of the workers at the club came up to me with a package, and it was a shoebox that some friends of mine from home, some Christian friends of mine had sent to me. They knew I was going to be at that club. They sent it to the club, and I open it up, and I'm looking at a loaf of bread.
Oh, you're kidding.
They sent me a loaf of bread as a joke.
You're kidding.
And I opened up the bread, and I took my hand, and I reached in there, and I just took the bit. I ate it. I ate the bread. And I was fed. It was a fucking miracle. And, you know, some people would call that coincidence.
Right.
I don't call it that. I call it, you will always be taken care of. You know, Jesus said something about the birds in the air. Do not worry. Because the flowers neither toil nor spin, and that whole verse.
It keeps coming up. It's the sixth chapter of Matthew. It just keeps coming up. That we don't need to worry that the birds are fed and the flowers are dressed more beautifully than even Solomon in all his splendor. And
thank you very much. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't have a Bible in front of me, but I've always taken that verse to heart.
Absolutely. As strange, it just keeps coming up recently in my life that every time, just recently that verse, do not, in the context of do not be anxious about anything, not to worry, and then he brings up the two bare necessities of life of food and clothing, and says if we're not to worry about these things, that God provides those, we can also conclude, well, how much less should we worry about sell a lot of records, or whether we are accepted by the press, or by whether we find somebody to marry, or whether we look good on a given day, or any of our concerns just seems so frivolous in light of that verse.
Right, right. It's everything's really just enjoy your life and be here now and enjoy what you're given, because you know you're here and it's really not that big of a deal. You know, I certainly would like to sell records.
Yeah,
but most importantly, I want to be around my friends and family. I want to be happy, and these people make me happy. And you know, if it were just you alone on the earth, it would be boring. Anyway,
would you say that your connection with your friends and family and those immediate relationships would be the motivation for your play music? I mean, one of the questions that I'd written down was whose reaction to your music is the most important? What I mean is, you know, do you pick up the magazines to see how many stars out of 10, you know, that you got on your new record, or do you hope more that the other guys that you're creating the music with like what you're doing, or is it the people that inspire the song lyrically, your family? Whose reaction or opinion do you value the most as far as the music that you write?
My friends, you know, I mean, they're the ones, you know, who are most critical and aren't afraid to tell me that sucks or right. That's great. You know, it's, you know, my friends are very blunt with me, and yeah. I respect that the most, because they're not, they're just not afraid to tell me the truth.
Do you feel responsible to communicate something of God or of your faith in the lyrics? And what I mean is, for many people I talk to, they just see themselves an entertainer. Other people feel like they have a specific agenda, whether it's political or religious, whatever it may be, or just to, you know, have a selfish ambition about trying to be respected as an artist or to meet girls or whatever it may be that makes people get up on stage. Why do you, who I read in an article recently, an interview with you where you describe yourself as a shy person, why do you get up on stage to sing these songs and then you know, of course, are flooded afterward with people who want to talk to you and who want your autograph and their picture with you. How does this make you feel as somebody who is introverted naturally?
Well, I get on stage and I do this because it's what I feel I'm supposed to do. And not that, I'm some great thing or something, but I feel it was something that I can do that I love and that, you know, was given to me. And many times I've wanted to quit music, you know, and just get married and have children and, you know, not tour and just live, like, on a farm with, you know, many different animals.
Yeah.
But that's not my calling.
Right.
Because so many people are inspired have told me that they're inspired by what I do. So I have to do it. I feel like I have to do it. And you know what else? I love it. I love it. I enjoy the meditation of music. I love sitting down and playing. And I don't particularly like to play shows and play the game and go on tour and advertise and sell myself. It's something positive, and there's nothing wrong with putting something positive out in the world. You know, if it changes people's perspectives, makes them not commit suicide, it makes them believe that maybe there's something more than the 9-to-5 or money or war. And it's a positive force, music. But it can be a negative force as well. But I choose the light side of the force, Luke.
Yeah.
And yeah.
May I ask, just from personal experience, a little that we've been able to, you know, make a go at it. And, of course, you know, we haven't been terribly commercially successful, so, you know, not compared with what you've experienced, you know. But I think there's probably something of the same struggles, regardless of the level, whether, you know, you're selling out stadiums or just playing, you know, VFW in your local town where people are telling you what a great job you're doing. That there be some sort of struggle, particularly for those trying to follow Christ, who taught this lowliness and this humility, and particularly that those who humble themselves will be exalted and those who exalt themselves will be humbled. Do you ever feel a tension in being exalted or being scrutinized, at being put up on a pedestal, or that people would want to know you and sort of elevate you above other people, and meanwhile you're thinking, boy, I'm just a normal person. In fact, I know I'm a crazy person. If you're anything like me, you think, why would you want to know me, and why would you know?
Right. I am a normal person, and if people, it's other people's problem if they want, you know, if they aren't aware, you know, that we're all brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
You know, I am a normal person, and I force myself to be one. I gotta be because I wouldn't be. Yes, I'm insane and scatterbrained, but you know, I am normal, and every single person on the face of the earth is just as welcome as the other, and I am just another one of them. And if people want to exalt me or push me, put me on a pedestal for being, you know, a musician, that's their problem, that's their choice, and
yeah,
I have nothing really to do with that. Or I'd like to at least act like I know. I mean, but I also exalt, you know, I exalt Christ, I exalt Bono, I exalt you, you know, but ultimately I know that the truth is we're all just here at the same time, and we're all welcome. We're all welcome. Does that answer your question, or am I losing track?
Very much. I guess partially you answered the question, in your describing the incident with the bread and you having given your money away. But I was wondering because of listening or reading something of an interview with you pertaining to the lyrics and the themes of the new record about, you know, you said something about simple answers to simple problems, that people are hungry and we should feed them. And I thought of a song I'd heard of yours years back. I don't know if it ever made onto a recording, but it was called Asleep Under Last Week's News. I presumably about the homeless, and it seemed like he was a recurring concern for the poor or for the needy. Is that something, I suppose it's sort of a two-part question. One, where did that come from? If that was inspired by the gospel, or if that's just a matter of sort of common human sense? or if it was strengthened by the gospel, perhaps. The other is how much you feel responsible to sort of take that burden upon yourself and continue to serve the poor, or to live among the poor, or to, as opposed to writing songs to talk about it. It's something that I struggle with. It's like,
beat it, you. I'm talking on the phone.
Sorry. How much we need to put this in what we believe into practice, as opposed to how much we need to talk about it or write about it or sing about it. Do you find, like, you need to find a balance there, or it sort of works itself out?
It works itself out. I mean, you know, like, I am the poor. I am poor. And how does it hurt to give somebody something when the phone's ringing? Sorry. No, I mean, how does it hurt you to give what you have? You know, of course. I mean, some people are there by their own choice. Some people are there because they want to be there. But either way, give unto others. And if someone asks you for your, you know, what was it? If someone asks you for, what's that verse in the Bible? If someone asks you
for your
tunic,
give
them
your tunic as well.
Shoes or whatever as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, the message is there. I can't quote it verbatim, but, you know, the message
right.
is there. It, you know, give all that you can and you're going to be okay. It's just like the bread thing. I've been homeless, but it was my choice. And I was very grateful that there were a couple people that I ran into that totally hooked me up and set me right back on track because of their givingness and their compassion for my situation.
When was that?
This was when I quit high school and I ran away from home. And, of course, I had, like, you know, I totally was set up. But, I was a teenager, and I just wanted to experience life, and I just wanted to run away and experience life. And people took care of me. God took care of me the entire time, so there's nothing wrong with giving. It's actually like the best thing ever.
One of the lines that stuck out to me, it moved me and touched me very dear to my heart, in the matter of forgiveness in the song "River to Sea." You said that I can make known forgiving waters that flow. It seemed to me like this. Well, there's a tenderness there. Bring to try to said I don't remember the preceding line exactly. I can't take away any man's hate, something like that.
Right. I cannot change any man's hate. I can make
known,
forgiving waters of love.
Forgiving waters of flow. Is this something that, I'm not sure if there's a real question here. I just wanted to sort of bring it up and connect with you, saying that I can identify with this inability to sort of to change anybody necessarily, but just to present this an alternative to hatred or to bitterness or to holding on to pain and depression and
that
sorrow.
Is exactly what I mean.
So the freedom and goodness that I've felt personally in the forgiving waters, and knowing that, as Christ said, he said, "Behold, I make all things new." And to me, I've felt that with forgiveness. So
right.
I guess I suppose I don't know if I should just if I should ask you if there was any particular encounter you had with either being forgiven or being forced to decide whether or not to forgive somebody who really hurt you.
There was a very particular, there have been many moments in my life that I've been forced to forgive, and that was by my own choice. At one point about 3 or 4 years ago, I was very angry.
Yeah.
I'd wake up every day just livid with life, not only because of the people that I was surrounded by, stupid people that need to, like, have war and, like, kill people, and I don't get it, and I was angry. And I'm furious every morning. And then one day I moved in with a friend of mine, and I projected all of my anger on him every morning.
Hmm.
He's a good friend of mine. And I was like, and then one day I stopped and I was like, what the hell am I doing? Like, this is my friend. This isn't his fault or his problem. It's actually my problem, and
right.
I need to change it. So even though it was difficult, I was still angry in the heart. I start putting on a smile. Even though I was livid still inside, I still tried to be gentle on the outside. Eventually, I started smiling on the inside.
Wow.
And though I get stressed and angry for good reason, sometimes to this day, my heart is no longer angry. But, you know, every once in a while, of course. You know, I got angry last night, but I don't put any value on it.
That's part of the beauty, it seems to me, is that no matter how many times we fall back into that, the forgiveness is always there, whether it's our ability to forgive others or our ability to come to God and simply and sincerely say that we're sorry if, you you know, I've gotten angry or I've hurt somebody, and the forgiveness is always there. To me, it's just tremendously good news, I think.
Right.
Like the prodigal son who, for all intents and purposes, should have been disowned, you know, went and squandered all the father's inheritance, and then comes back to his father humbly saying, I don't deserve to be even your son. And then the father, rather than scolding him, runs to him and embraces him and weeps over his son. And that's always been one of my favorite images in the scriptures of God's love for us, where all it takes is just a small amount of humility to say, yeah, I'm sorry. And God is so willing to forgive us. And also particularly the example of Christ on the cross in the Gospel of Luke when he's being killed. And he's been put up on the cross after being mocked and spat upon and beaten and so on. And what's his response to all this but to pray, forgive them, Father, they don't know what they're doing, without them even apologizing. I suppose I'm just sharing it so I can connect with this theme of forgiveness. I found such tremendous freedom there in fixing my eyes on that example where I can think for the rest of my life, no matter what anybody ever does, if somebody could insult me or run me off the road or talk about me behind my back or a girlfriend could cheat on me or whatever it may be, and nothing would compare it to what Jesus was put through, and yet he still forgave and still prayed for those who were hurting him. And I think, boy, with that in mind, how can I ever hold on to any of this darkness again? I agree with exactly what you said, that, you know, rather than blaming others, we our own heart and say, wow, this is really my own problem,
right?
Because I'm choosing to hold on to this. It may be sort of
it's your responsibility. You are just like the others. And I've so many times had that mindset, you know, of everybody else and blamed on others, but it's, you're the same thing. You're the same person. And it's just what you choose to do with the choice that's been given to you by God or life or whatever. It's your responsibility to deal with the light or dark, not to be too Star Wars.
No, well, it's clear. It's only Star Wars because it's sort of an archetypical human experience. This is what we're all here wondering, is why are we here? What's brought us here? What's our responsibility now? What's the right way to live? And this always involves light and darkness. That when you are honest and let the truth in and don't hide things and don't try to manipulate people, this is the light. Everybody knows right from wrong. I believe in our hearts. You know, it's sort of written there. Yeah, I don't worry that, you know, I mean, shucks, the very lyrics that you sang, one of our songs on the record deal, you know, in our darkness, light shines. You know, that this is
right.
Sort of a theme I'm always coming back to, which is just so simple, maybe, I hope not become a cliche, because it's still just as relevant as ever. Today's issues are exactly the same as they've ever been. You know, should we forgive or should we hold on to anger? How do we deal with evil? Do we try to hunt down and kill people who are evil, or do we try to overcome evil with love?
Right.
You know, what do we do when people are hungry and we have extra? You know, do we share with them or do we hoard up more for ourselves to make sure that we're always protected? In whom are we trusting for our protection? These are just eternal themes.
Right.
But I wonder how much you think you feel compelled to talk about these things that would, you know, sort of try to change the world or change the direction of people's belief or their lives, as opposed to just talking about, well, I suppose the name of the first Sunny Day record would lend itself to, you know, you saw it more just as a cathartic, an emptying of your own emotions, a diary, you know, sort of a personal expression of whatever's going on inside, regardless of anybody's reaction to it. Do you feel like you have to strike a balance there, or again, is it just a natural, whatever comes out? It may help people. It may just be, you know, you're just sort of letting it all out, but that's what it is. How do you view that?
It is what it is. I mean, at the time, for Diary, I was just, like you said, just sort of feeling it and how I felt at the time. And frankly, it was all about a woman. I was in love, and my heart was broken, and it took me 7 years to get over it. And
wow. Yeah, I'm in the same boat, brother.
Oh, really? Your heart was broken.
Yeah, for me, it's somewhere around 8 years, but it has a happy ending. Things are good now, but...
Right, likewise.
Yeah, we're right around the same time frame, but forgive me, go ahead.
Things worked out. But now, like, the older I get, the more I am aware of the world around me. When before, the younger I was, it was just sort of all sort of centered within this brain. And then I started to look out and just notice that, like, you know, with war and stuff and the whole, everything that's going on now with our president and, you know, actually he's not my president. I don't even believe in lines. But yeah, and the more that I started to be aware of that, the more I felt somewhat of a responsibility to
to start saying more important things as opposed to just being so internalized. It's something I'm working on. You know, I'm not like a great lyricist, Dylan or Lennon, you know, who did some amazing stuff. You know, he's a huge advocate for love, John Lennon, you know, in his later years. That's definitely a style that I admire. And I like Bono, you know, like Bono is a hero of mine because of not only what he does musically with U2, but also what he does politically. I think it's incredible that a rock star can make a political change.
Current administration, and I guess that's one of the other things I was wondering, didn't know if I'd get to it, but since you brought it up, this issue of our political leaders being so closely tied with Christianity and using the name of Christ,
right,
the religious language of ridding the world of evildoers or of going on a crusade against terror and things like that, that this, for me, has caused a great amount of difficulty in reconciling my own faith with the nonviolence Jesus, you know, and what I've understood as true Christianity, and then, of course, this very different brand of Christianity that believes in bringing about, apparently, peace through war and goodness through evil, that I just see as sort of blasphemous or heretical or tremendously harmful.
Well, it's insane. Like, no one ever listens to the message of Christ or the message of Gandhi or, you know, or Martin Luther King. Like, you know, like people say, you know, use the name, but totally do not, you know, people think it's so taboo to say Jesus and that, wow, you're bound down to this guy. But if you would ever read the message, it's the greatest thing I've ever seen. It's incredible. It's love. People, you know, with that four-letter word doesn't even explain. You need to experience it and understand. You need to become aware. So easy to be blinded.
So you don't worry that in even mentioning the word God or being tied in whatever way with Christ, that you'll be associated with this very different, you know, sort of political party and this whole other view of what that means and what it has come to mean for Americans. Do you find yourself shying away from the language of Christianity as a result of being sort of being...
I have completely shied away from the dogmatic idea of religion, but I want to get to this point where I embrace it for myself and understand it individually rather than as a whole. Nobody can tell me... And I will not. Nobody can tell me what I understand. I have to understand and experience for myself to take it to heart. As an individual, I have to understand so that I can truly believe and not blindly believe. And that's what religion is to me, is a lot of times blindly believing because someone told you. But I was always somebody who needed to experience and understand it for myself because that was more important.
The role of community or of common worship or of common faith among others, where if you do reach a point of, as an individual, coming to believe God, is there a point in which you feel compelled to find a unity with others in that, like whether it be, you know, a church, some kind of a traditional Sunday church meeting or group of people that you can meet with and just talk with an open heart?
You and I are having that community right now, you know, like we're having that conversation, you know, and that is my community. And I have that community with atheists, but I don't go to a church anymore.
Yeah.
I have been probably two or three times in the past few months. What I'd like to do is start, I don't know how it's going to pan out, but what I'd like to do is maybe start going to like a Buddhist temple, you know, one day, and then, you know, the next go to a Catholic church, and the next go to a Muslim, and experience, as sort of what you were saying, you know, with your parents and stuff, sort of experiencing like a you know, I don't want to be Unitarian, but I want to respect God and life. It just so happens that Jesus is the one that showed me the light, you know,
right,
through, you know, and that's how I relate to it, and that's where I want to be within that understanding. But I also think there are absurd religions, obviously, and so I don't subscribe to everything, but that's
right,
all about, as an individual, filtering out the unnecessary, and judging by the fruits.
Yeah, I tend to agree that wherever we are, you know, whatever we're doing has something holy, or the potential for holiness and transcendence. You know, I was talking to my friend the other day who said when he was pouring the cream in his coffee and stirring it around, he saw the swirl of the mixing of colors and saw the galaxies, revolving and spinning in the whole cosmos and God's
wisdom. What's this? I'm sorry?
A friend of mine is sort of a mystic and halfway wild card, really deep kind of guy who loves God very much but can't seem to fit God into sort of any sort of religious constraints. He was just telling me that he was pouring the cream into his coffee. To him, he saw the cosmos spinning and something holy and something eternal and infinite right in front of him in something as mundane as a morning coffee. And, of course, for many people will gauge your spirituality by these outward forms. Are you attending a church building on Sundays? How often are you reading the Bible? How many times did you say a certain prayer in a given day? But when you open the scriptures, and I think even look in your heart, you see where something that St. Paul wrote, he said, whether you eat or drink, do all things for the glory of God.
Right.
And elsewhere he said, though I surrender my body to the flames and speak with the tongue of men and angels, and if I have not love, I gain nothing. He said, even if I surrender all I have and give to the poor, and I have not love, I gain nothing. It seems like from these different scriptures, we can do things that seem very religious and holy on the outside, but if our motivations are impure, we can go to church all the time, even be a pastor or be a nun.
And never understand.
If it just becomes a matter of judging others or of elevating ourselves over others. But apparently we can pour cream into a cup of coffee and give genuine thanks to God for whatever goodness brought about those coffee beans and whatever cow made that cream and however that mug came to be and the clay that forged it and all the miraculous that goes into something as mundane as drinking a cup of coffee can so often be taken for granted and be unhappy and cynical about all that's wrong in the world when everywhere around us is God revealing this eternal and beautiful wonder, a mystery that we could spend the rest of our lives and in fact probably a thousand lifetimes just marveling at and standing in awe of, and instead we get bored and turn on the television. So it seems like I have to come back to you sort of saying, boy, as much as I always looked around and blamed everything else for my problems, my anger, for me it's been that same thing with my doubts, that I always struggle with where is God, where is God, why doesn't God show up in the clouds, why doesn't God come to me in some
right.
prove that there is a God, and that, whatever I may want to believe on a given day.
What I doubted, I was just like, if I don't see God coming out of the clouds and on all these things, I just have to look to guys like Jesus and just take his word for it. It's like that makes all my doubt go away because he's right, man. He was plugged in. He was completely plugged in to the reality and the truth of life. That makes all doubt go away. If I don't believe it in myself, just trust him. He had it right. And then that makes your faith come right back. That's how I like to look at it. Is that weird?
Yeah, I have to agree that turning to Jesus when I have my doubts and I look to him, and particularly some of the teachings of where he just was so unexpected about his closeness to God that he came in such a backwards way. People were expecting the Messiah to be a king and to be a mighty ruler to overthrow the Roman government. And here comes this insignificant, scrawny Jewish guy who wasn't a political leader, wasn't a wealthy, noble king riding on a horse. He was poor and he was homeless and he went hungry and he spent his time with prostitutes and drunks and sinners, and he scolded the religious leaders and the political leaders and the respected people and the wealthy people and turned the whole order upside down. It's no wonder, of course, executed for all this, but when you look at his life and his death, and of course, if we believe his resurrection, you have to know that this guy was on that point, that when he said, I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, words I speak come from the Father, what I do comes from the Father. I like you, I've kind of loosened up with my dogma as far as you need to accept the Trinity, and this is what God is, and this is how I can explain exactly how it all works. I can explain how it all works, but I can trust that Jesus, who came to the sick and healed them and came to the blind and gave them sight and came to those in power and undermined their power by bringing a kingdom of a different sort and bringing strength through weakness and bringing power through humility, and such a backwards way of approaching, blessedness through poverty and blessedness through hunger and through lowliness. It's just, who would think of this? Who would ever want to do this? It's just crazy enough that it's got to be true. It's sort of how I feel some days.
A friend of mine has a friend who died. And when this person died,
a friend came to him, and you know his heart stopped, everything, and flatline. And a friend came to him in this place in his death and said, you know, you're not done. You need to go back. And he asked the question to his friend, you know, what is life about? Like, you know, what am I doing? You know, and his friend basically said, it's all about how you treat other people. And what is love but other people? Like the only, like love is not just like a concept. It's how you treat, it's all about other people. I'm sorry if I'm being a little bit confusing, but.
No, not at all.
Love exists only because other people exist. And you have to treat people with kindness and generosity and everything that you can do to make them happy and yourself happy. And his friend came back to life and started treating people with love. That's something that I always think about when I'm an asshole.
Yeah, that'll do it.
I gotta get back on track. Just
right.
Treat people good. It's really quite simple.
Yeah, it is. It is, and I'm grateful for that simplicity, because I'm not always the brightest guy, and I always have the patience to, you know, study the most deep philosophies or complex ideas. But that simple reality of loving others is seems to be tremendously solid. It's sort of what we're all after in all of our fumbling and craziness. We all sort of know that. That's what we want, and every sort of conflict seems to be as a result of our failing to live up to that, or someone else is failing to live up to that, and then we strike back in some way. There again, for Christ to teach and to exhibit not just a love for those who love us back, like an exchange, I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine, but a love even for, as he put, for our enemies, for those who hate us or for those who slander us or curse us, to return that with love and to return that with a blessing.
Right.
It seems like it would put an end to every conflict in the entire world if even one person in the conflict could follow the example and the teaching of Jesus. Yeah, it's just, again, tremendous freedom that I've found in that teaching, a simple reality of love with no boundaries, without any expectation of being loved in return or being,
right,
appreciated for it or being paid for it or being even going to heaven for it or any after
right,
life
right, right.
sort of reward, but just for its own sake and because of its own inherent goodness and value, that sort of is the stuff of heaven. We don't have to wait until we die to experience, as it says.
Heaven is here.
Yeah.
I don't know who said that, but I believe it.
But Jesus, he said the kingdom is within us and among us, waiting
right.
to be found. And Paul wrote that today is the day of salvation.
Wow.
Now is the time. So that there's no sense in looking to a future we don't even understand or can't imagine what it is, when right now is when we're called living this love and bringing it into practice. In fact, in the very Lord's Prayer, it says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we're praying that the kingdom of paradise would come on earth right now. It's not a matter of when I die, how do I avoid hell? What is this paradise, and where is this love, and how do I bring it now to whoever I'm talking to? It so happens I'm talking to you right now, and we're on the phone, and we're 3,000 miles or so away from each other, and there's somebody listening and, like, recording all this to eventually write it.
Hey, guys.
There's something slightly strange about the whole thing, to be, like, listened to and have somewhere in the back of my mind the whole time, not only this is going to be printed in some magazine, but also, holy shit, I'm talking to Jeremy Enig of all people. Like, there's all this sort of silliness where I've...
this is, like, the coolest interview ever, by the way. I don't know. I mean, you guys got... I don't know how you're going to pull this one off, but... this is, like, timeless. This is going to be around until the Earth is, like, destroyed or from the sun or whatever. But anyway.
Well, my hope is, like,
this is insane.
That right now, whatever is happening, that this is not, that it isn't an interview. It's why I felt a little silly trying to ask any of the questions that I've written down with, like, this intention of, well, how is it going to come across and what will be printed and how, and any of my concerns. Meanwhile, you said brothers, in a sense. Or even though we don't really know each other very well, that there's this connection that's so deep that at this very moment...
there's an understanding.
Right. And can share something of that community that we're all searching for, something of the unity. So I guess, I don't know, it's like off the record or what have you, you know, my life is fairly available to, you know, to you. If you ever... I don't have a cell phone or, like, a house or anything that's very steady, but whether it's email or just whenever I see you, I hope that I can show you something of the love that I've felt and the gratitude I feel toward you in particular for, you know, for working with us and for everything you've done to inspire me, but not because you're, you know, talented at writing songs, you know, and has a beautiful voice or anything. You do. You are. But that's really not what gives you your value, you know. You're,
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Tremendously valuable just as a human being. But I can't, it's hard for me to see you that way, you know. So I feel like a bit of a hypocrite talking about all this love, and the back of my mind all the while is like, wow, this is too cool, you know.
Right, yeah. So, we're always dancing around, you know. Hypocrisy, all of that. Yeah, like I've been dancing around the whole day, like hypocrisy, you know. So it's no worries.
Well, thank you. I hope
I love you too.
Well, thank you. I hope you'll forgive me for ever seeing you in a silly way or trying to you know impress you by whatever I have to say or you know in any ways I wish to think of you as you know whatever. It's just that none of it has to amount to anything. But if you ever you know care to talk or anything, you know, that I'm not too hard to find, you know, and hopefully we can have something of a, you know, a community, something of a church meeting, whenever we come together, you know, as Jesus said, where two or three gather in my name, there I am. So I'm sort of trusting in that, even right now, and in this conversation, that we are not just gathered in the name of, like, Synthesis Magazine, or, like, Jeremy Enig, LLC, or, like, Me Without You Incorporated, you know, but
right,
there's something, hopefully we both are trying to, you know, gather in some sort of unity around this point of goodness, you know, and of hope, and I don't know, the fact that people will be reading this, perhaps, does give me the sense of responsibility to say something, like, inspiring or true, but, you know, to hell with all that I think and the way things will work out.
Having a conversation.
But it's hard, you know, I have to admit, it's just hard, and it feels, it's some level, I'm still just, I'm still sort of struggling with knowing how to be any day. This is just a particularly awkward situation, but I barely know what to say under normal circumstances, and I've never considered an interview, or much less this, a certain normal circumstance. I mean, we're on this fiber optic magic silver boxes talking from halfway around the globe. It's all a mystery to me. You know?
You're insane, in the best way. Wow, I was so stressed today, because I'm juggling like five things, and I feel relaxed again, and so thank you so much.
Wonderful. Thank you.
I'm so not stressed anymore, and so,
wonderful. I was afraid. I was so nervous and awkward, I thought I'd just add some trouble to your life by, you know, however you got wrangled into this. I was asked by our manager, of course, I said, what do you think? Yeah, I'm going to do it. Well, I'll talk to Jeremy and, you know, open up about this. Whatever we want to talk about, it sounds great. But I didn't know how you'd react, so I'm grateful that you were even willing to talk with me. And it sucks that something good could come of it. Well, alhamdulillah, as my mom says, is Arabic for all praise be to God. For anything good that comes, it seems like a nice day to be talking to you. And I'm very, very grateful. You know?
Thank you. You too.
Jeremy Enig and Aaron Weiss. Both have albums in stores now and available for purchase online. Thanks for listening to this podcast. Go grab more at synthesisradio.net and find all sorts of music, art, fashion, and film news at synthesis.net.